This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book in Convent Walls, The Story of the Dispensers by Emily Sarah Holt. Part 1. Chapter 1, Wherein Dame Cicely de Chaucombe Scribeth Soothliness, 1360. Wherein commence the annals of Cicely. Heaven does with us as we with torches do, not light them for themselves. Shakespeare. It is of no use, Jack, quoth I never did love her, I never can and never shall. And I never bade you, Ciso, answered he. Put that in belike, prithee. But you bade me write the story out, said I did so. But I left you free to speak your mind of anybody that should come therein, from a bishop to a baal lamb, said he. Where shall I go for mine ink? I made answer. Seeing that some part of my tale to correspond to the matter should need to be writ in vernage, one and some other in verjuice. Keep two quills by you, saith he, with inkhorns of the twain, and use either according to the matter. Ay me, said I. It should be the strangest and woefulest tale ever writ by woman. The more need that it should be writ, quoth Jack, by them that have lived it and can tell the soothfastness truth thereof. Look you, Ciso, there are men enough will tell the tale of hearsay, such as they may win of one and another, and that is like to be full of guile and contrariousness. And many will tell it to win favor of those in high place, and so shall but the half be told. Thou hast lived through it, and wist all the inwards thereof, at least from thine own standing spot. Let there be one tale told just as it was, of one that verily knew, and had no purpose to win gold or favor, but only to speak soothfastness. You set me in hard task, Jack, I said, and I think I sighed. Easier to do, maybe, than to reckon on, saith he in his dry Tholmode way. Thou needest write but one word at once, and thou canst take thine own time to think what word to write. But I have no parchment, said I am a little afraid I coveted not any, for I fancied not the business at all. It was Jack who wanted the story writ out fair, not I. Well, I have, saith Jack calmly. Nor any quills, said I. I have, saith Jack, after the same fashion. And the ink is dried up. Then will we buy more. But, I stayed, for I thought I had better hold my tongue. But I have no mind to it, saith Jack. That might have come first, Ciso. It shows, when it doth, that thou hast come to an end of thine excuses. Nay, sweetheart, do but begin, and the mind will have after. Lack-a-daisy, said I, trying to laugh, though I felt somewhat irked, worried, irritated, I reckon then I had best do mine husband's bidding without more ado. There spake my Ciso, saith he. Good dame. So here am I, sat at this desk, with a roll of parchment that Jack hath cut in even leches strips for to make a book, and an inkhorn of fresh ink, and divers quills, oh me, must all this be writ up? Well, have forth. I shall so content Jack, and if I content not myself, that shall pay me. It was through being one of Queen Isabel's gentlewomen that I came to know these things, and as Jack saith, to live through my story. And I might go a step further back, for I came to that dignity by reason of being daughter unto Dame Alice de Lethegrieve, that was of old time nurse to King Edward. So long as I was a young maid, I was one of the Queen's sub-damsels, but when I wedded my Jack, and a better Jack never did maiden wed, I was preferred to be damsel of the chamber, and in such fashion journeyed I with the Queen to France, and tarried with her all the time she dwelt beyond seas, and came home with her again, and was with her the 4 years following, until all brake up, and she was appointed to keep house at Rising Castle. So the whole play was played before mine own eyes. I spake only soothfastness when I told Jack I could never love her. How can man love whom he cannot trust? It would have been as easy to put faith in a snake because it had lovesome marks and coloring, as in that fair, fair face. I will not deny that it was marvelous fair, with the gleaming eyes which now seemed to flash with golden light, and now to look like the dark depths of a stagnant pool. Wonderful eyes they were. I am glad I never trusted them. Nor did I never trust her voice. It was as marvelous as the eyes. It could be sweet as honey and sharp as a two-edged sword, soft as dove's down and hard as an agate stone. Too soft and sweet to be soothfast. She meant her words only when they were sword and agate. And the king, what shall I say of him? In good sooth, I will say nothing, but leave him to unfold himself in the story. I was not the king's foster sister in sooth, for I was 10 years the younger, and it was Robin, my brother, that claimed kin with him on that hand. But he was ever handy, amiable, kindly, courteous to me. God rest his hapless soul. But where shall my tale begin? Verily, I have no mind to set forth from the creation, as chroniclers are wont. I was not there then, and lived not through that, nor of a long while after. Must I then begin from my creation? As wassay, as who should say, that is to say, as near it as my remembrance taketh me. Nay, I think not so, for then should I tell much of the reign of King Edward of Westminster, Edward I, that were right beside the real story. I think I shall take date from the time of the Queen's first departure to France, which was the year of our Lord God, 1324. I was a young maid of 17 years when I entered the Queen's household, her own age. But in another sense, I was tenfold the child that she was. Indeed, I marvel if she ever were a child. I rather think she was born grown up, as the old heathen fabled Minerva to have been. While on waiting, I often used to see and hear things that I did not understand, yet which I could feel were disapproved by something inside me. I suppose it must have been my conscience. And if at those times I looked on my mother's face, I could often read disapproval in her eyes also. I never loved the long secret discourses there used to be betwixt the queen and her uncle, my lord of Lancaster. They always had to me the air of plotting mischief. Nor did I ever love my lord of Lancaster. There was no simplicity nor courtesy in him. His natural manner, when he let it be seen, was stern and abrupt, but he did very rarely allow it to be seen. It was nearly always some affectation put on. And I hate that, and so doth Jack. At that time I loved and hated instinctively, as I think children do, and at 17 years I was a child in all things save by the almanac. I could rarely tell why I did not love people, only I did not love them. I knew oftener why I did. I never thought much of Sir Piers de Gaveston, that the king so dearly affected, but I never hated him in a deadly fashion, as some did that I knew. I loved better Sir Hugh le Despenser, that was afterwards Earl of Gloucester, for he. Siso, saith a voice behind me, what is the name of that chronicle? I cannot tell, Jack, said I. What wouldst have it called? The Annals of Sicily, quoth he, for she is beginning, middle, and end of it. I felt as though he had cast a pitcher of cold water over me. I sat looking at my parchment. Read it over, prithee, saith he, and count how many great eyes be therein. So did I, and by my troth there were 77. 77 of me, and all in 6 leaves of parchment forsooth. How many soever shall there be by the time I make an end? That's an ill beginning, Jack, said I, and I felt ready to cry. Must I begin over again? Siso, quoth he, nothing is ever undone in this world. What mean you, said I. There was man died the year before thou wert born, he made answer, that was great friend of my father. He was old when my father was young, yet for all that were they right good friends. He was a very learned man, so wise in respect of things known but to few, that most men accounted him a very magician and no good Christian. Howbeit, my father said that was but folly and slander. He told my father some of the strange matters that he found in nature, and amongst them one thing which hath ever stuck by me. Saith Friar Roger, nothing is ever destroyed. Nothing that hath once had being can ever cease to be. Why, Jack, cried I, verily that must be folly. I cast this scrap of parchment on the chafer, and it burneth up. It is gone, see thou. Surely it hath ceased to be. No, saith he. It is gone into ashes and smoke. What be ashes and smoke? Asked I, laughing. Why, they be ashes and smoke, he made answer. And the smoke curleth up chimney, and goeth out into the air, and the air cometh up Siso's nose thurls, and feedeth her bodily life, and Siso maketh 77 eyes to 6 pages of parchment. Now Jack softly, said I. So it is, my dame, pursueth he. Everything that dieth feedeth somewhat that liveth. But I can go further, and thou wilt. Friar Roger thought, though he had not proved it, that every word spoken might as it were dwell in the air, and at bidding of God hereafter all those words should return to life and be heard again by all the world. I could not help but laugh. Why, what a din, said I. Do but think all the words in all languages, buzzing about man's ears, that were ever spoken since Adam dwelt in the Garden of Eden. Wouldst thou like all thy words repeated thus, Siso? I would not mind, Jack. Wouldst not? Then I am worser than thou, which is like enough. I would not like to hear all my foolish words, all my angry words, all my sinful words echoed back to me from the starry walls of heaven. And suppose, Siso, only suppose that God should do as much with our thoughts. I dare say he knows how. I covered my face with mine hands. That would be dreadful. I whispered. It will be in very deed, softly said Jack, when the books are opened and the names read out in the light of that great white throne which shall be brighter than noonday. I reckon in that day we shall not be hearkening for Sir Piers de Gaveston's name, nor for Sir Hugh le Despenser's, but only for those of John and Cicely de Chaucombe. Now, set again to thy chronicling, my Siso, and do it in the light of that throne and in the expectation of that book, so shall it be done well. And so Jack left me. But to speak sooth, seeing the matter thus makes me to feel as though I scarce dare do it at all. Howso be I have it to do, and steadfast way maketh steadfast heart. There were plenty of people who hated Sir Hugh le Despenser, but I and my mother Dame Alice were not amongst them. He had been brought up with the king from his youth, but the king never loved him till after the death of Sir Piers de Gaveston. The queen loved him, just so long as the king did not. That was always her way. The moment that she saw he cared for anything which was not herself, she at once began to hate it. And verily he never gave her cause, for he held her ever dearest of any mortal thing. Sir Hugh was as goodly a gentleman as man's eyes might see. Those who loved him not called him proud, yea, the very spirit of pride. But the manner they thought pride seemed to me rather a kind of sternness or shortness of speech, as if he wished to have done with the matter in hand. Some people call everything pride. If man talk much, they say he loves to hear his own voice. If he be silent, he despises his company. Now it seems to me that I often speak and am silent from many other causes than pride, and therefore it may be the like with other folk. Do those which are ever accusing other of pride, do all their actions for that reason? If not so, how or why should they suspect it in other men? I do not think Sir Hugh was so much prouder than other. He knew his own value, I dare say, and very like he did not enjoy being set at naught. Who doth so? Other said he was ambitious, and there might be some soothfastness in the accusation, yet I fancy the accusers loved a slice of worldly grandeur no less than most men. And some said he was wicked man, that did I never believe. As for his wife, Dame Eleonora, I scarcely know what to say of her. She was a curious mixture of qualities. She clung to the king, her uncle, when others forsook him, she was free-handed, and she could feel for man in trouble, those were her good points. Yet she seemed to feel but what she saw, it was out of sight, out of mind, with her, and she loved new faces rather too well to please me. I think for one thing, she was timid, and that oft-times causes man to appear what he is not. But she was better woman than either of her sisters, the Lady Margaret Audley and the Lady Elizabeth de Clare. I never saw her do, nor heard her say, the heartless acts and speeches whereof I knew both of them guilty. I dare say, as women go, she was not ill woman. For, alas, I have lived long enough to know that there be not many good ones. Well, I said, no, did I? That I would begin with the year 1324 of our Lord God. But, lackaday, there were matters afore 1324, like as there were men before Agamemnon. Truly, methinks there be a 2-3 I did well not to omit. As wassay, the dying of Queen Margaret, widow of King Edward of Westminster, which deceased 7 years earlier than so. I shall never cease to marvel how it came to pass that two women of the same nation, of the same family, being aunt and niece by blood, should have been so strangely diverse as those two queens. All that was good, wise, and gentle was in Queen Margaret. What was in Queen Isabel will my chronicle best tell. This most reverend lady led a very retired life after her husband's death, being but a rare visitor to the court, dwelling as quietly and holily as any nun might dwell, and winning love and respect from all that knew her. Very charitable was she and most devout, and, if it be lawful to say thus, had I been Pope, I had sooner canonized her than a goodly number that hath been. But I do ill to speak thus, seeing the Holy Father is infallible, and acts in such matters but by the letting of God's Spirit, as saith the Church. Good lack, but there be queer things in this world. I saw once Father Philip screw up his mouth when one said the same in his hearing, and saith he, The Lord Pope is infallible when he speaketh ex cathedra, but so only. But how, saith he that spake, shall we know when he is sat in his chair and when he is out of it? An odd look came into Father Philip's eyes. Master, saith he, when I was a little lad, my mother told me divers times that it was not seemly to ask curious questions. But I guess what the good friar thought, though it be not always discreet to speak out man's thoughts. Ah me, will the time ever come when man may say what he will, with no worse thereafter than a sneer or a sharp rebuke from his neighbor? If so were, I would I had been born in those merry days, but I should want Jack to be born then belike. Siso, saith a voice over my shoulder, wist thou the full meaning of thy wish? Jack is given to coming in quietly, I never knew him make a noise, and peeping over my shoulder to see how my chronicle maketh progress, for he can well read, though he write not. What so, Jack, said I? I reckon we should be the younger by some centuries, quoth he, and perchance should not be at all. But allowing it, dost thou perceive that such a difference should mean a change in all things, that no fear should in likelihood mean no reverence nor obedience, and might come to mean more than that? That were dread, said I. What manner of times should they be? I think, saith he, those very tempora periculosa whereof St. Paul speaketh, when men shall love their own selves and be proud, unthankful, without affection, peace, or benignity, loving their pleasures rather than God. And if it serve thee, I would not like to live in those times. Dear heart, nor would I, quoth I. Yet surely, Jack, that seemeth a gainsaying. Were all men free to speak what they would, and not be called to account therefor, it were soothly to love their neighbors and show benignity. Aye, if it were done for that end, he made answer. But the heart of man is a cage of deceits. Much must befall the world, I take it, ere that cometh to pass, and while they that bring it about may be good men that mean well, they that come to use it may be evil and mean ill. The devil is not come to an end of his shifts, be thou sure. Let man run as fast and far as he will, Satan shall wit how to keep alongside. I said not. Jack is very wise, a deal more than I, yet I cannot always see through his eyeglasses. Mayhap it is not always because I am wiser of the twain. Freedom to do good and be good is a good thing, then saith he, but freedom to be ill and do ill must needs be an ill thing. And man being what he is, how mockest thou sure that he shall always use his freedom for good, and not for ill? Why, that must man chance, said I. A sorry chance, answereth he. I were liever not to chance it. I thought I heard thee deny Fina this last week to go to the dance at Underby Fair? So thou didst, said I. She is too young, and too giddy belike, to trust with a bevy of idle damosels as giddy as she. Well, we are none of us so far grown up in all wisdom, that it were safe to trust us with our own reins in all things. Hast never heard the saw, He that ruleth his own way hath a fool to his governor. Well, said I, but then let the wise men be picked out to rule us, and the fools to obey. Excellent doctrine, my Siso, quoth Jack, smiling in his eyes, at least for the fools. I might somewhat pity the wise men. but how to bring it about? Be the fools to pick out the wise men, and are they wise enough to do it? I sorely fear we shall have a sorry lot of governors when thy law comes to be tried. I think, wife, thou and I had better leave God to rule the world, for I suspect we should do it something worser than he. Let me fall back to my chronicling. Another matter happed in the year 1319, the which I trow I shall not lightly forget. The queen abode at Brotherton, the king being absent. The year afore, had the Scots made great raids on the northern parts of England, had burned the outlying parts of York while the king was there, and taken the Earl of Richmond prisoner, and now, hearing of the queen at Brotherton but slenderly guarded, down they marched into Yorkshire, and we, suspecting not, were well nigh caught in the trap. Well, I mind that night, when I was awoke by pebbles cast up at my casement, for I lay in a turret chamber that looked outward. So soon as I knew what the sound meant, I rose from my bed, and cast a mantle about me, and opened the casement. "Is any there?" said I. "Is that thou, Cisso?" quoth a voice which I knew at once for my brother Robert's. "Lose not one moment, but arouse the queen, and pray her to take horse as speedily as may be, or she shall be captured of the Scots, which come in great force by the Air Valley, and are near hand, nearly at mine heels. And send one to bid the garrison be alert, and to let me in, that I may tell my news more fully." I wist not whether I shut the casement or no, for ere man might count 10 was I in the queen's antechamber, and shaking of Dame Elizabeth by the shoulders. But good lack, she took it as easy as might be. She was alway one to take matters easy, Dame Elizabeth de Mohun. "Oh, let be till daylight," quoth she as she turned on her pillow. "'Tis but one of Robin Lethegreave's fumes and frets, I'll be bound. He is for ever a-reckoning that the Scots be at hand, or the house o'fire, and he looks for man to vault out of his warm bed that instant minute when his fearsome news be spoken. Go to sleep, Cicely, and let folks be." And round turned she, and I warrant was asleep ere I could bring forth another word. So then I fell to shaking Joan de Villiers, that lay at t'other end of the chamber. But she was right as bad, though of another fashion. "Wherefore rouse me?" saith she. "I can do naught. 'Tis not my place. If Dame Elizabeth arise not, I cannot. Thou wert best go back abed, dear heart. Thou shalt but set thyself in trouble." Well, there was no time to reason with such a goose, but I longed to shake her yet again. Howbeit, I tarried no longer in the antechamber, but burst into the queen's own chamber where she lay abed, with Dame Tiffany in the pallet, taking no heed that Joan called after me. "Cicely, Cicely, how darest thou? Come back, or thou shalt be misbaid or tint. Held in displeasure or ruined." But I cared not at that moment, whether for mispayment or tinsel. I had my duty to do, and I did it. If the news were true, the queen was little like to snyb blame me when she found it so, and if no, well, I had but done as I should. And I knew that Dame Tiffany, which tended her like a hen with one chicken, should hear my tidings of another fashion from the rest. Had Dame Elizabeth lain that night in the pallet, and Dame Tiffany in the antechamber, my work had been the lighter. But afore I might win to the pallet, which to do I had need to cross the chamber, Queen Isabel's own voice saith from the state bed, "Who is there?" "Dame," said I, forgetting to kneel, in such a fluster was I, "my brother hath now brought tidings that the Scots come in force by the Air Valley with all speed, and are near hand at the very gate, wherefore?" The queen heard me no further. She was out of her bed, and herself donning her raiment, ere I might win thus far. "Send Dame Elizabeth to me," was all she said, "and thyself bid de Nontoil alarm the garrison. Well done. I count I am not perfect, nor a saint, else had I less relished that second shake of Dame Elizabeth that was fast asleep, and deliverance of the queen's bidding. I stayed me not to hear her mingled contakes and wayments, reproaches and lamentations, but flew off to the outermost door, and unbarring the same spake through the crack that wherewith I was charged to Oliver de Nantoil, the usher of the queen's chamber, which lay that night at her outer door. Then was naught but bustle and stir both within and without. The queen would have up Robin, and hearkened to his tale while Alice Conan combed her hair, the which she bade bound up at the readiest, to lose not a moment. In less than an hour, methinks, she won to horse and all we behind, and set forth for York, which was the contrary way to that the Scots were coming. And ah me! I rayed with Dame Elizabeth, that did not but grieve over her lost night's rest, and Harry poor me for breaking the same. I asked at her if she had better love to be taken of the Scots, since if so the queen's leave accorded we might have left her behind. Scots, quoth she. Where be these ghostly, fabulous, figurative Scots? I will go bail they be wrapped of their foldings, plaids, fast asleep on some moor 100 miles hence. 'Tis but Robin the clown that is so clust, stupid, with his rashness, that he seeth a Scot full armed under every bush, and heareth a trumpeter in every corncrake, and as if that were not enough, he has a sister as ill as himself that must take all for gospel as if Friar Robert preached it. Mary love us, but I coca when thou gattest hold on me by the shoulders. I count it was a good hour ere I might sleep again. Dear heart dame, cried I, but it was not 2 minutes. It is scantly an hour by now. Then that is thy blame, Cicely, routing like a bidel, shouting like a town crier, and oncoming, assaulting folks as thou dost. I marvel thou canst not be peaceable. I alway am. Canst mind the night that ever I shaked thee awake, and made thee run out of thy warm bed, as if a bear were after thee? I trust I kept out of my voice the laughter that was in my throat as I said, No, dame, that cannot I. The self-notion of Dame Elizabeth ever doing thus to any was so exceeding laughable. Well then why canst, body o' me? Whatever is yonder flaming light? Master Oliver was just alongside, and quoth he dryly, Burden not your ladyship, 'tis but the Scots that have reached Brotherton, and be firing the suburbs. Holy Mary pray for us, scries Dame Elizabeth at last verily feared, Cicely, how canst thou ride so slow? For love of all the saints, let us get on. Then fell she to her beads, and began to invoke all the calendar, while she urged on her horse till his rapid trotting break up the avzand or as into fragments that man might scarce hear and keep him sober. I warrant I was well pleased, for all my weariness, when we rayed in at Micklebar of York, and so I warrant was Dame Elizabeth for all her impassibility. We tarried not long at York, for, hearing that the Scots came on, the Queen removed to Nottingham for safer keeping. And so ended that year. But no contakes had I, save of Dame Elizabeth, that for the rest of that month put on a sorrowful look at the sight of me. On the contrary part, Robin had brave reward from the King, and my Lady the Queen was pleased to advance me, as shall now be told shortly thereafter. And ever afterwards did she seem to affy her more in me, as in one that had been tried and proved faithful unto trust. Thus far had I won when I heard a little bruit behind me, and looking up as I guessed, I saw Jack over my shoulder. Dear heart, Jack, said I, but thou hast set me a merry task. 2 days have I been at work, and not yet won to the Queen's former journey to France, yet I do thee to wit, I am full disheartened at the stretch of road I see afore me. Must I needs tell everything that happed for every year? Mary love us, but I feel very nigh at my wit's end but to think of it. Why, my chronicle shall be bigger than the Golden Legend and the Morte Arthur put together, and all Underby Common shall not furnish geese enow to keep me in quills. I ended Beatwick's laughter and tears. To say sooth, I was very nigh the latter. Take breath, Cisso, saith Jack quietly. But dost thou mean that, Jack? I mean not to make a neef serf of my wife, saith he. I was something comforted to hear that. As for time, dear heart, he pursueth, take thou an hour or twain by the day, so thou weary not thyself, and for events I counsel thee to make a diverse form of chronicle from any ever yet written. How so, Jack? Set down nothing because it should go in a chronicle, but only those matters wherein thyself was interested. But that, Jack, said I, laughing as I looked up on him, shall be the annals of Cicely over again, wherewith I thought thou wert not compassionate. Pleased, satisfied, the adjective of compassion. Nay, the annals of Sicily were Sicily's fancies and feelings, he made answer. This should be what Sicily heard and saw. I sat and meditated thereon. And afore thou wear thy fingers to the bone with thy much scribing, saith he, with that manner of smile of his eyes which Jack hath.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.